Among my many accomplishments, there's one that I'm most proud of, and that's the fact that I might have taken the most dangerous selfie in the world. I'm the man who appeared in a photograph next to what's now called Chernobyl's elephant's foot. I'm the guy that set up a camera for a shot next to a great big pile of nuclear fuel that contained melted concrete and metal, a hyper-radioactive mass that was so dangerous when it formed that if you stood next to it in minutes, the cells in your body would start to hemorrhage. Stay there 2 minutes and you'd fall to the floor and start throwing up. And if you'd hung around a minute longer, within 2 days, you'd be dead. My name is Artur Korneev, and this is my story. So this is me standing next to that elephant's foot, and you're probably wondering how I'm able to speak to you today given the fact that this shouldn't be possible. But let me start with how I got to that pile of heated death before I tell you how I overcame it. As you all know, on April 26, 1986, there was what you might call a pretty big problem at the Chernobyl nuclear power plant in Ukraine. At Unit 4 of that power plant, technicians had gone ahead with the safety test, which, to say the least, was ill-advised. The reactor was blasted apart by steam, and what ensued was an eruption of radiation that killed many people and scarred the very planet. Some of the workers died immediately, but what you didn't know at the time was that many of the rescue workers and firefighters that got close to huge amounts of radiation would die painfully and slowly. That radiation would seep into their bodies and virtually eat them from the inside. Thousands of others would take in smaller amounts of radiation, and just how many of them would die from radiation-related cancers is anyone's guess. Some of those people were the inhabitants of the city of Pripyat, where the plant was located. On the night of the disaster, they gathered together and watched in shock as a great beam of light lit up the night sky. What they didn't know is that this thing they were observing was potentially their murderer. It was chaos, utter chaos. Soon the cleanup job was on the way, and in all maybe 500,000 people were involved, risking their lives for the safety of others. And this is where I come in, your faithful and dedicated photographer. I was sitting at home after the disaster, having been filled in by some of my colleagues over in Ukraine about just what had happened. I had no idea as to the extent of the damage and just how destructive it would be, but I knew that what had happened would likely change the world forever. Nuclear reactors are not supposed to explode. How did I know any of that? Well, you might not have heard of me, but back when I was in my mid-30s, when the reactor blew its lid off, in my native Kazakhstan, I was considered perhaps the most renowned radiation specialist. Not to blow my own trumpet, but let's just say that me and radiation have had a very long love-hate relationship. I might have well been exposed to more radiation than anyone else on this planet, which is another of my great, if not dangerous, accomplishments. I knew I'd get the call. "Hey, Mr. Korneev, we need your help. The Soviet Union needs your help. Comrade Korneev, your flight has been booked and we expect to see you today." In a way, that might have translated to, "Comrade Korneev, we are expecting you to go on a suicide mission. Say goodbye to your loved ones now, because you likely won't see them again." What you need to know about the blast is that while the fire was incredibly big and the radiation released was nothing short of catastrophic, all that merely came from about 5 tons of fuel. That was bad enough, but there was about 200 more tons of this highly radioactive fuel still in the bowels of the plant. If that went up, the disaster would have been beyond anything you can imagine, and the fallout of that would have been bodies stacked from Ukraine to Sweden. They wanted me to go into those bowels of the building and determine just how much radiation was leaking. The mission was one of great importance, since the cleanup job couldn't go ahead until they knew just how much radiation there was. I bid farewell to my family and friends, and I assured them I'd be back and that I would return in good health, which was a lie, of course, but crying a river of tears is not how we did things back then in Kazakhstan. I had a job to do, and the safety of countless people was my responsibility. I got on that plane and quickly downed 2 straight vodkas, something back home we might refer to as taking your medicine. The place was chaotic when I arrived. Men were rushing around, traipsing through muddy fields, sat in groups drinking vodka, hardly saying a word to each other. These were brave men, courageous souls, whose fearlessness in the face of death was astounding. I was told I'd be taking a team into what you might call the belly of the beast. That was a steel and concrete structure they built around the reactor to limit the leakage of that dangerous radiation. We called it the sarcophagus, and we knew all too well that any man that entered this structure might not have long to live. When I first came eye to eye with the thing, it was like walking up to the gates of hell. There should have been a sign over the entrance that read, "Abandon hope, all ye who enter here." What we discovered inside was beyond our expectations. At first, we just looked around and checked the levels of radiation. Materials everywhere were leaking that stuff, and sometimes we just kicked hardened fuel out of the way. As they say on TV, we don't suggest you try that at home. I wasn't wrong when I compared the sarcophagus to hell. That radioactive fuel had become so hot, it had turned into a kind of hot sludge, a lava that took with it anything in its path. Uranium, zirconium, concrete, metal, sand, all flowed through the building and eventually burned right through the floor. It was a scene Satan himself would have been proud of. Once that lava had cooled down a bit, it hardened, and in places we saw masses of it that looked to us like waterfalls that had frozen. 11 tons of the stuff would in time pile up in one of the corridors, and that giant mass would become what we now call the elephant's foot. It would be my backdrop for the most dangerous selfie in the world. For years I'd return to that place despite the dangers and check out the radiation levels. You have to remember, for a long time after this disaster stopped filling your daily TV news channels, inside the sarcophagus was still a very dangerous place to be. Since I first arrived at Chernobyl those first few days after the disaster, I'd been back hundreds of times. I've seen the devastation, and I've never relinquished my fear of the beast. That foot you see next to me, when it was first formed, gave off 10,000 Röntgens an hour. That might not mean much to you, but it's enough to kill a man if he stood next to it for a matter of minutes. It took me some years to get next to it, but let me tell you, when I finally did, it was still extremely radioactive. So you're now wondering, just how am I still alive and telling you this story? How a 71-year-old Kazakh is still speaking when he should have been another victim whose life was painfully ended by acute radiation syndrome? Well, you could say that I've just been lucky. The fact is, viewers, I should be dead, but I'm not. I don't visit hell these days. I've probably had my fair share of radiation over the years. Even when I took a journalist down to see the elephant's foot back in 2001, that mound of malignancy was still measuring 800 Röntgens an hour. To put that into perspective for you, the limit that's considered safe is 0.3 Röntgens per week. Okay, so these days my health isn't that great, but at least I'm alive. I'm what you might call a bit on the sickly side, and my vision isn't what it used to be, but I've been to hell and back hundreds of times, and I'd go again if they hadn't barred me. Apparently, they think I might have overdone it with the radiation exposure. The radiation is contained now, but make no mistake, it isn't going to disappear just yet. That elephant's foot is still nice and warm, but I don't suggest you visit and give it a rub. Yeah, things are better, but that mound is still a formidable monster. One thing I can tell you is that the Soviet radiation is the best radiation in the world. It's one of my jokes, by the way. You can call it Kazakh dark humor. That's a fascinating story in itself, but we're guessing some of you haven't heard the full story of the Chernobyl disaster. Lucky for you then, here on the Infographics Show, we've researched the matter a bunch of times. So have a look at one of these videos. How I Survived Chernobyl, or What Caused the Catastrophic Nuclear Accident in Chernobyl?